Before we get started, I just want to clear something up here now that it's a new year and, you know, because there's just not that much to be said about Gangster Squad. I take a lot of guff for giving bad reviews to the two Expendables movies, but the thing is, I actually really like macho action movies when they're, you know, good. Even ones with Sylvester Stallone. Case in point, his next movie.
You and me, we got a little unfinished business to take care of.
What are we, Vikings?
You don't just kill a guy like that.
I just did.
See? That looks good. That's possibly how you do one of those. Anyway, let's talk about Gangster Squad.
Gallo! Gallo! Gallo!
Can't shoot me. You're a cop.
Not anymore.
Well, that's disappointing. Granted, the first new movies out of the gate in any given year are usually no great shakes, the general theory being that everyone is out of money in early January and small luxuries like moviegoing are the first things to get budgeted out, so why bother releasing anything anyone wants to see? Still, I'd been looking forward to Gangster Squad because of its fantastic cast and the fact that director Ruben Fleischer had banked a lot of goodwill off of his debut with Zombieland. So much goodwill, in fact, that we all seemed willing to forget that he followed it up with 30 minutes or less. Unfortunately, Gangster Squad turns out to be a quintessential January movie, intermittently amusing but forgettable and overall lifeless, squandering a lot of potential on what appears to be a series of misses and bad decisions. It almost feels unfair to be critiquing the film in its current state, since it's fairly well known that the film is missing one or more of its key scenes, having been re-edited in the wake of the Aurora, Colorado massacre to remove a scene and a story point involving a mass shooting in a movie theater. It's impossible to know exactly how much those edits have changed the original product, but the film does feel like it's suffering from an impromptu gutting of one kind or another. Too many scenes feel rushed and clipped, sub-stories and arcs appear too suddenly and are resolved even faster, and almost nobody gets any kind of development in a cast of characters that really isn't that large to begin with. The story is a heavily fictionalized version of the battle between gangster Mickey Cohen and the LAPD in post-World War II California, with Sean Penn as Cohen and Josh Brolin as the leader of the off-the-books vigilante police unit of the title. Ryan Gosling is a morally conflicted sidekick, Giovanni Ribisi is the tech guy, Anthony Mackie and Michael Pena are the black guy and the Latino guy, respectively. I'm not even being cheeky, that's really the entirety of their two roles. Robert Patrick, hey, always nice to see him, is an old-fashioned cowboy gunfighter, Nick Nolte is some kind of shambling golem inexplicably elected to police chief, and Emma Stone is on hand to stand around looking beautiful but hopelessly anachronistic in old-school glamour puss getup. It's the kind of movie where when John Polito shows up, you have to wonder what took him so damn long. Yes, John Polito. You have seen this man in, like, hundreds of TV shows, movies, etc. Now you know his name. At the very least, you can kind of see what the movie was going for, dusting off all of the iconic gangland movie tropes that haven't seen much traction in a while and imbuing them with the energy and pacing of modern action movies. It's a good idea, much like it was when Brian De Palma did it in The Untouchables, but the execution is all over the damn map. The action scenes aren't particularly memorable and often descend into the realm of physical comedy at bizarrely inappropriate times, and nothing going on is quite stylized and operatic enough to justify the archness of the characters and their surroundings. It's fun to realize that despite the authentic historical feel, Penn is playing Cohen as some kind of Batman nemesis.
We'll find out! Los Angeles is my destiny.
It won't ever happen again. I swear to God.
You're talking to God, so you might as well swear to me.
You're gonna be begging for a bullet before it's over.
But he's the only one who seems to be in on the joke, so instead of being iconic, which seems to have been the intent, everyone just comes off as one-dimensional. There's a few moments where it looks like the film might be taking off in more interesting directions. The first scene shows off some unexpected gore that would seem to foreshadow a more subversive, dangerous final product that never materializes, while the requisite subplot about Brolin's character's long-suffering wife takes a really welcome and surprising turn away from the expected path, but then doesn't know what to do with it. It's not that there aren't any good parts or memorable individual moments on display, it's that they never add up to anything other than a greatest hits collection of motif shots and dialogues you've seen in a dozen better, or at least better remembered gangster movies. That kind of pastiche was acceptable from, say, L.A. Noir, since video games hadn't really tried to tap 50s West Coast gangland oeuvre to any depth before, but movies have been doing this dance forever, you have to step your game up. Ugh. Man, it's gonna be a long slog until March. See you next time!